Good morning and welcome to those of you joining us in the building and also online. Thank you. It's kind of good to be back together, but I know there's still a lot of illness going around. So we thank you for staying home if you don't feel well. And we do offer online access, and if you miss something, you can always go back and check out the service that you might have missed, because those are all archived on our website. So thank you for being here. A few announcements. Next Saturday, men's breakfast at 8:30 to 10 a.m. We will be breaking bread, both physically and spiritually, and we ask you to join us, the men to join us for that. Awana has resumed, so know that there's a Wednesday night. It's going to be a busy place. Spice of Life is scheduled for February 10th, and as I understand from Jody, it will be the second Tuesday of every month through the spring. Second Saturday, every second Saturday. Yeah, not Tuesday. Don't show up Tuesday. There'll be a bunch of kids in the basement in school. yes, every second Saturday, and again next month, February 10th, it will be starting back up. So thank you for being here. Thank you for joining us, and let's worship together. Thank you.
Amen. Welcome. It's good to be together. Please keep Pastor Mark and Carol in your prayers this morning. They're not feeling well, and we're grateful for Dr. Luther Smith being here to speak this morning. Our call to worship this morning is from Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Let's pray together. Father, on this first Sunday of a new year, we trust in you. You are our shepherd. We commit ourselves to you. We have nothing to bring to you, but we accept your grace and your guidance in our lives. Thank you for your mercy and grace to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and worship together this morning.
Open up my eyes to see all of you, your mysteries. I hold my breath, you hold my hand, as heaven melts the heart of man. How amazed I am.
Found this. This one has the kind of less familiar lyrics, so be on the lookout for those. Let's give them a try together.
Praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet.
Transition to the missions moment, and we'd just like to remind you, even though we don't have the bulletin, that we do have many missionaries, and you know who they are. As God brings them to your heart and to your mind this week, thank you for being faithful to pray for them. Corey and Bethy Anderson had that wonderful Christmas concert and presentation, and they're following up on that. We have various other, we know what's going on because we do very clearly communicate with our missionaries, which I appreciate. Also, Josiah and Lydia and Clover are here this morning, and they will be going back to resume their training. When do you start again?
January 15th.
January 15th. So coming right up, they're continuing to work to be translators, and if you want to know about their work, please just contact them after the service, and they'll be glad to share that with you. It's been a joy to be a part of that preparation time. It's so very important. Also, just some of our own prayer requests for our body. Cammy continues to struggle and has had some pain, and we need to continue to be fervent in prayer for the Cranks as they go through this, and the family as they walk through this with her. And thank you for doing that. Also, Bill Butler and Doug Langmaid, and those we know in our congregation who continue to work through physical things. And we need to be thankful and pray for each other from a spiritual standpoint as well. We struggle physically because we live in a world that our bodies continue to break down when you're my age. And we know we have a lot of illness, and so pray for people that you know are struggling, and as God brings them to your heart and to your mind. Let's bow in prayer. Father God, you are King, whether we acknowledge it or not. You are King forever. You will reign forever. And it's up to us to glorify you and praise you for that fact, because you are King. King above all kings, Lord above all lords. And we thank you for that. We thank you for who you are. We praise you. We praise your name. And we thank you for creating and for sustaining and for sending your Son to die on the cross for our sins. We thank you for your Holy Spirit who lives within us. Lord, what a tremendous gift. What a tremendous gift. We ask that you would be with the people in this congregation who are struggling physically. Lord, for the Cranks, continue to surround them with your grace, your love. May they sense that keenly this week. Lord, for Bill and Cheryl, that daily struggle, that daily look at what does the day hold, how can we get through the day, is really poignant in their lives right now. It's really strong, and we thank you that you're sustaining grace in their lives. Help us to support them with love and with prayers. Lord, for those in this body who are struggling physically in other ways that we may not even know about, God, may you bring them back to health and encourage them, and may they look to you. May they use illness, physical illness, to point to you as all in all and the great healer. Lord, we thank you for that. God, we thank you for this morning together. We thank you for the sunshine. We thank you for this building, the opportunity to be here. God, we are grateful. We are grateful. And we would ask for our missionaries this week, bring them to our hearts and our minds. You know which ones are struggling. You know which ones have specific needs. And we don't always know those. But I would ask that your Spirit would be very active in just bringing those people to our hearts and our minds so that we can pray for them and be a part of that ministry as well. Thank you. We love you. In your name, amen.
Amen. If you would stand together one more time and let's sing a hymn as we prepare to look into God's Word together with Dr. Smith this morning. While we sing kids up through fifth grade, keep an eye out for that slide to head downstairs to Children's Church if your family would like. Let's sing before we look into God's Word.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best God by day or night.
Remain standing, and I'm going to read to you this morning. I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians 15, verse 50, through the end of the chapter, which is 8 verses. One of my favorite passages. What am I saying, brothers and sisters, is this. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor can corruption inherit incorruption. Listen, I am telling you a mystery. We will not all fall asleep, but we will all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we will be changed. For this corruptible body must be clothed with incorruptibility, and this mortal body must be clothed with immortality. When this corruptible body is clothed with incorruptibility, and this mortal body is clothed with immortality, then the saying that is written will take place. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Woe, death, where is your victory? Where, death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, be steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the Lord's work, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Amen. Brother Luther, come share with us.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi. You, well, let's pray first, because last time I forgot to tell you to be seated. You guys were standing and stuff. Let's go ahead and pray, and then you guys can be seated. Lord, thank you so much for the opportunity to be here. Thank you, Lord, for your grace and your word. We pray for Mark and his family, Lord. May they recover quickly and be brought here, back here to serve the brothers and sisters here at Open Door. At this time, Lord, may this time be productive, instructive, and may overall you be glorified. We love you so much, for it's in your Son's name. Amen. You may be seated. Okay. Today, I'm sure that you guys have read 1 Corinthians 15. It is one of my favorite passages as well. I'm going to ask you guys, though, to put your thinking caps on. It is Thinking Cap Sunday today. Okay? So we're going to be going through this text. It's a real easy read if you just read through it. But we're going to be walking and looking at, smelling the roses, right? Looking at some things. Okay? There are some notes in the back, just in case you need them. Let's go ahead and get started. Paul is writing to the saints of Corinth, and he's addressing some issues here. They have written him a letter, and he is responding to this letter. He mentions this earlier in this letter in 1 Corinthians, and man, Corinthians has got some issues. They got problems. Hashtag, they've got issues, right? And Paul is informing them about some of these things. He is making things right. Now, I find it to be very fascinating that even though the saints of Corinth, the believers in Corinth, have some problems, he never doubts that they are believers, ever. He calls them saints, dearly beloved. He even tells them that they are expecting the revelation of Christ in chapter 1. An amazing passage. We don't have time to go through all of the issues that he deals with, but we are going to deal with one of them, strictly the resurrection. This was an issue for them, and Paul is telling them to put their thinking caps on, right? Let's go ahead and read verse 1, because I don't got a lot of time. As a matter of fact, let me break this down a little bit. Okay, so point number 1 is the reminder of the resurrection. As a matter of fact, we can say that verses 1 through 11 is the reminder of this particular truth. Okay? Let's go ahead and read the first two verses, and then we will make some observations here. He goes, "Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which also you stand, by which you are saved, if you hold fast to the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain." My brothers and sisters, we got to talk about some things here in verse 2. First, Paul made this known to the believers in Corinth about the good news that he heralded, literally, or proclaimed, taught to them. Okay, that's verse 1. Pretty simple. In verse 2, Paul reminded them that they had received this message. They took it in. They believed it. That they are positioned, or that they stand in this message, and that they will be saved or delivered by this message. Now, whenever we see this word saved, we have to ask the question, saved from what? Okay. We might say saved from damnation, saved from hell, saved from the wrath of God, right? All of those are legitimate answers. However, what does the context tell us? We will come back to this question later, okay? So just stick it in the back of your mind, write it down. It's on your notes, so don't worry about it. But stick it. Oh, by the way, I did not mention, as I always do, as customary as I come, if there is a point that resonates with you, I'm not going to tell anybody, okay? You can say amen out loud, okay? I will not think that you're charismatic if you do that, okay? I won't. I will not call you a heretic, okay? Amen, I will go, amen. There you go. All right. That preach it is good too. I'll take that. Let's come back to this question later. Okay. Paul stated a condition. This is a conditional statement in verse 2. He says, "By which you are saved if you hold fast to the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain." Now we have to understand conditional statements here. This is known as a first class conditional statement. Okay. I don't want to get too much into the mechanics, but just trust me on this. You can go back and look it up if you want. This is a first-class condition. This is a statement that is assumed to be true. Okay? It is assumed to be true. Since this condition concerning this word is assumed to be true, the other, you know what an if-then statement is, right? If one part of the statement is true, then the other part of the statement is also, right? That makes sense. So the conditions have been met for this. So you can translate this and be right. You're not going to be violating the word if you do this. You can take that if and translate it as since, because the conditions have been met. How do we know this? We know this by the language. For example, the word received in verse 2. Okay, which you received, verse 1, you received, is in the aorist indicative. What in the world does that mean? Aorist just means that this was an event that occurred without any reference to time. It happened, okay? They received it, right? We don't know when. We know that they did, right? Perfect. And an indicative is a statement of fact. Okay? I am a man. I know that most people will argue this in this culture. Okay? But that is a fact. That is an indicative statement. Okay? So they receive this. Amen. Right? And they stand in it. This is in the perfect tense. It is complete. Okay? So they don't have to continually stand in it. They stand in it. Period. Okay? All of these people that Paul is referencing are believers. So we can translate this as this. "Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which you also received, in which you also stand, by which you're also saved, since you hold fast to the word I preach to you. Okay? Unless you believed in vain, for nothing. What does this mean? We will get to this in a little bit. Just know that the word here is eke. Okay? Just keep that in mind. In vain, empty, for nothing. Paul points to the saints of the believers back to the message that was given to him and underscores it with the Hebrew scriptures. This is verses 3 and following. For I delivered to you as of a primary importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. Then that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. Right? Verse 3, Christ died for our sins in accordance with the text, with the scriptures. Pretty simple. That he was buried and was raised according to the scriptures. The Hebrew scriptures. I'm thinking of Isaiah 53, for example, right? That talks about his death, burial, and resurrection. There are many other passages that talk about this. And that he appeared physically. Not like Casper, okay? We're not doing this. Jesus didn't do that, okay? He didn't come with the, you know, with the sheet, okay? He appeared physically, touch, okay? To all these people, this is found in verses 5 and following. He says that, and that he appeared to Cephas, Peter, then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 brethren at one time, most who remain until now, although some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared to me. Think of the road to Damascus. Jesus showed up physically to Paul on the road to Damascus. This was not a phantasm, some type of figment of his imagination. Jesus appeared. Physically, remember he ate with the apostles, did he not? He cooked meals, he cooked fish for them, had a fish fry for them, right? Paul then underscores in verses 9 through 11 the validity of the apostolic ministry. In verses 9 through 11, he says, for I am the least of the apostles and not fit to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me did not prove vain. But I labored even more than all of them. Yet not I, but the grace of God with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preached and so you believed. What was Paul's motivation? Paul's going to tell you what his motivation is in a little bit. He's going to get to that. He talks about his history, him persecuting the church of God. But by God's grace, him being called as an apostle, sent out to proclaim the gospel to them and to others in the region that God had sent him. What was Paul's motivation? He will talk about that. So, the reminder of the resurrection of Christ is important in this text. That's point number one. The reminder of the resurrection, that Christ died, was buried and raised, and he appeared to all of these individuals as validity of the of his physical resurrection. And because of that, the apostles were encouraged, they were strengthened. Paul was personally strengthened by this. And this brings us to point two, the implications of this resurrection. My dear beloved in Christ, this is the rest of the chapter. All of it. Verses 1 through 11 is the setup. That is the set, it is the introduction. All the rest of it is implications. Let's talk about this because this is kind of cool, the structure and how Paul writes. Okay? The first section in verses 12 to 18, Paul brings up two logical arguments. They are logical. It is beautiful the way that he writes. Awesome. Hey, if I had more time, we'd go through this a little more slowly, but we don't. So we're going to go through a little bit more quickly. In 1 Corinthians, again, chapter 15, verses 3 to 8, we just read this, right? This is Paul talking about the gospel, the resurrection of Christ, and how it was told in the Hebrew Scriptures. Notice what it says in verses 12 and 14. This is kind of cool. Now, if Christ is preached, which is what that is, verses 3 to 8, that he has been raised from the dead, how do some of you, some among you all, say that there's no resurrection of the dead? You see the problem? Some of the saints in Corinth were becoming unconvinced that Jesus resurrected physically. How do some among you say that there's no resurrection of the dead? But if there's no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is vain and your faith is also vain. Check this out. If Christ didn't die, the Hebrew Scriptures are worthless. That's what he's saying. They are worthless, and our preaching is in vain. You see that word that's highlighted in red there? That's the same word that's found in verse 2. Let's read it again, because I'm getting ahead of myself here. By which you are saved, since you hold fast to the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. This is the point that he's making here. If you don't believe, or if you're not convinced that Christ resurrected physically from the dead, the Hebrew Scriptures are worthless. All of it. Not just some of it. All of it. Do you not understand the implications of this? Paul's statement essentially is connecting the resurrection of Christ with reality itself. If Christ didn't resurrect from the dead, folks, reality would cease to exist. It's amazing. Paul added a hypothetical to the saints of Corinth. If the message concerning the Messiah is proclaimed, specifically concerning Christ's resurrection from the dead, and if Christ was not raised from the dead, the message Paul gave to them is kenosis. Oh, we know this word. This word is found in Philippians 2, right? That Jesus, although being God in human form, did not consider equality with God as something to be grasped, but emptied himself, made himself nothing. That's the same word here. The message is empty. It is without benefit. It is not profitable. It's not true if Christ didn't resurrect from the dead. Why are you following this then? This line of thought, again, is associated with the adverb eke, which is found in verse 2. They're believing Christ and the message of the resurrection. If Christ is still dead and in the grave, their believing for this result would be for nothing. If this is true, then we all should pack up our things and go home. But let's look at the second argument that Paul makes. This is fantastic. Remember, in verses 9 through 11, Paul gives his ministry of the apostles, right? He gives it to them, right? The reason why the apostles were sent out and the reason why he was made one by Jesus himself, who physically came to him and them. Notice what he says here. In verses 15 to 19. Moreover, we are found to be false witnesses of God, because we testified against God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith, that is your doctrine, what you believe to be true, is worthless. You're still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ have been destroyed, perished. If we have hoped in Christ in this life only, we are all men most to be pitied. We're a joke if this isn't real. And not only a joke in this age, but in a joke, shall I say, 2,000 years of history, we would be a laughingstock. We would be no different than the cults that we speak against if this was not true. The apostles would be considered liars, and those who have gone before us in Christ, there would be no hope for them at all. They would be destroyed. So if we take the first section of 1 Corinthians and tag it to verses 12 and following, and take the second half, notice the logical argument that Paul makes. He's putting it all on the line here, guys. It's amazing. If God did not raise Christ, Paul and those who were sent by God testify that he did. They are lying on God. You know that statement. Why are you lying on me? Right? They're lying on God. They're saying that God did something when he didn't and said things that he didn't. If this is the case, Paul says it impacts several things. One, the instruction that they are convinced of is useless. That's verse 14. Their sins were not satisfied in the sight of God. Folks, we are in trouble. Because the death and the satisfaction of our sins is not just hinges upon the death of Christ, but the resurrection. The resurrection validates that God accepted that sacrifice. It validates it. And that's applied to us when we believe. But if Christ didn't die, it wouldn't make a difference. Those who have died as believers are condemned and destroyed. Oh boy. I would really say if this is true, we should live it up. Because this is the best we're going to get. Paul's big point, if this is all true, from verses 1 all the way to 18, if this is all true and the hope of believers found in this life only, then we're the dumbest people on the face of the land. Dumbest people. We've been duped, bamboozled, horn swindled. Well, that's not good. Let's pray. Have a nice Sunday. No. No. It gets better because we have another section. The second section is the order of operations. Verse 20. You know, Paul doesn't leave them hanging. He gives them information that is fantastic. Verse 20. But now Christ has been raised. Wonderful words. Amen. Right? Amen to that. He has been raised physically. Notice, Paul gave the reality of the resurrection and calls it the first fruits, right? In verses 21 and 22, he says he compares a man through whom physical death entered into the world. Verse 21, for since by a man death, by a man also the resurrection of the dead. Wonderful. We know this. Through Adam, all die. Right? Makes sense. But in Christ, we find the resurrection of the dead. Christ died and he resurrected. and he didn't die again. He lives an indestructible life. Oh, so good. Verse 23, he gives the order of resurrection. This is so cool. Because Paul could have just said, he could have just stopped there and said, hey, you know, resurrection for everyone who believes. You get a resurrection, and you get a resurrection, and you get one, like Oprah with the cars, right? But he gives the order of how this goes. This is so fantastic. Notice here. We have Jesus Christ, the first fruits, verse 23. The first fruits, by the way, historically, is when you get the first fruits, you bring that, not only do you bring that into the temple, right? But that first fruit is the head of the harvest that guarantees the rest of it is going to come. You want to look for that, okay? So he is the first fruit. Then you have the saints at his appearing. Hey, that's us. For those saints who have died, you know, those people who we miss in our lives, those who have passed away that we think about often, we get to see them again. As a matter of fact, they get to go first. They are resurrected. And those of us who are alive, well, we get caught up with them. Amen. Amen indeed. Then comes the end, verse 24. That is the end of the age. This is verse 24. Then the end, when he hands the kingdom over to God and Father, and he's abolished all rule and authority and power. For he must reign until he puts all enemies under his feet. Isn't that a wonderful promise? Ain't nobody overthrowing this person. He must reign until he puts all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that will be abolished is death. Isn't that fascinating that death is known as a foe? It is an enemy to be destroyed. It is not a comfort to us at all. It's an enemy to be toppled. And we can't do it. No matter how many youthful creams we use, or multivitamins we take, or how many times we dye our hair so the gray will leave. We can't do it. But the last enemy to be destroyed is death, for he has put all things in subjection under his feet. But when he says he puts all things into subjection, it is evident that it is expected who put all things into subjection to him. When all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to the one who subjected all things to him, so that God may be all in all. Look at this, man. The doing away with death, and lastly, after that, we have the eternal age. Ain't that something? He lays it all out there. He tells us what's going to happen. That's hope, folks. The expectation of the things that God promises. Oh, my gosh. So he gives two logical arguments. He gives the order of operations of how this goes. And then we have, essentially, in the third section, the reasoning of Paul. Paul goes back to his own thoughts, his own ideas, his own concepts, his own motivations. He says this, otherwise, what will those do who are baptized for the dead? Now don't get too, okay, we're not talking like, you know, Mormons here. Okay. We're not talking about water. Okay. Baptism is just another word for identification. Okay. I'll talk about that in a little bit. Otherwise, what will those do who are baptized for the dead? If the dead are not raised at all, then why are they baptized for them? Why are we also in danger every hour? I affirm, brethren, by boasting in you, which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord, I die daily. If my human motives, I fought with wild beasts at Ephesus, what does it profit me if the dead are not raised? Let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. Isn't that fascinating? Paul tells us his motivation. It's not just that Christ died. It's that Christ died and rose. That's his motivation. And if Christ died and rose and we're going to rise, well then, man, bring on the wild beasts then. That's Paul's motivation. It's the resurrection. Man, this is why Paul was got whipped with lashes, in danger of his countrymen, shipwrecked twice, rocked asleep. I mean, think about this. All of the struggles that Paul went through throughout his ministry, what motivated him was the fact that he knew that he was going to be resurrected, and that the saints in Corinth, and all of those who he impacted, as well as the apostles, would be resurrected also. Paul's point here mentioned that without the resurrection from the dead, all of this suffering, all of this hardship, why would we look to the saints of old if Christ didn't die? Or if Christ died and didn't rise? They would not be examples. The reason why they are is because we anticipate that we will see them. That is the point. Do not be deceived. Bad company corrupts good morals. Verse 34. Become sober-minded as you ought and stop sinning, for some have no knowledge of God. I speak thus to your shame. They lost their focus, and it impacted their actions. And so Paul is reminding them, hey, the resurrection is my motivation. It ought to be yours, too. You ought to be motivated by this. It will impact your decisions and how you live and the things that you think about. Oh, but there's more. Like the ShamWow guy, there's always more. Fourth section, A Tale of Two Men, verses 35 to 40. Let's go ahead and read it. But someone will say, how are the dead raised? And with what kind of body do they come? Notice he anticipates the question here. You fool! That which you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And that which you sow does not sow the body which is to be, but a bare grain, perhaps wheat or something else. But God gives it a body as he wished. And to each of these seeds, a body of its own. All flesh is not the same flesh, but there's one flesh of men, another of beasts, another flesh of birds. Okay? And another of fish. But there are also heavenly bodies and earthly bodies. But the glory of the heavenly one and the glory of the earthly is another. There is one glory of the sun, one of the moon, right? And the other glory of the stars, for even stars differ from star in glory. Ain't that something? So, again, logically, he's talking about, now he switches. First he talked about the order of the resurrection, how this is going to happen. Now he's talking about the nature of the body and what will happen when we receive it. Oh! I wish I could give you my head and just give it to you. Oh, man. I tell you, man, it makes me want to run around this place, man. People will think I'm charismatic after this. He talks about the potential of the body using examples found on land, again, such as agriculture, in verses 36 to 38. He says, that which you sow does not come to life unless it dies, and that which comes to life, and that which you sow, you do not sow the body which is to be, but a bare grain, perhaps of wheat or something else. Right? We should know this. Us who live in farmland, you put a seed in the ground, and that seed is the potential, has the potential to grow into something great, to become something different than what it was before you put it in the ground, right? Makes sense. He uses agriculture to describe this. Then he talks about the variation of bodies found in creatures, verse 39, that all flesh is not the same. But there's one flesh of men, and another flesh of beasts, and another flesh of birds and fish. And you can tell the difference by looking at it, right? Human beings and beasts, animals, birds, and fish of all types, you know them by looking at them because their flesh or their bodies are different. Then he talks about the variations of bodies found in the heavens. Notice this here. He's using creation. Think of Genesis 1, maybe. The variations of bodies found in the heavenlies. The sun, the moon. He even mentions the stars, all of the luminaries. They're even different in the way that they look. What does all of this point out? He begins to underscore this in verse 42. So also is the resurrection of the dead. Oh. Just like all of these examples, agriculture, fish, beasts, human beings, sun, moon, stars, they all differ. It's so it is with the resurrection of the dead. The body you have won't be the body you get. I'm talking about the way, I'm talking about without sin. I'm talking about just as Jesus was raised with an indestructible life, so will you be raised. And that's what he's getting at here. So is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown perishable. I hate this body. It is raised and imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. Anybody dealing with any sicknesses here? Nah. Various diseases and things like that. Weaknesses. Just getting old. But it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual. Oh my gosh. The state of our body is even different. If there is a natural body, there's also a spiritual body. Man. And then we get to the tale of two men. Look at this. I skipped all this because I got ahead of myself again, like I usually do. Goodness gracious. We can read it. It's there. Then we get to the tale of two men. The first Adam, and who Paul calls the last Adam. I find it interesting that he doesn't say Jesus. He could say that. There's the first Adam, and then there's Jesus. We already know it's Jesus, right? But why does he refer to him as the last Adam? Because his body is different than Adam's. His nature is different than Adam's. Oh, Paul, man, I can't wait to see you. Notice in verse 45. So it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living soul. The last Adam, a life-giving spirit. However, the spiritual is not first, but the natural, then the spiritual. The first man is from the earth, earthly. The second man is from heaven. As is the earthly, so also are those who are heaven. As is the earthly, so also are those who are earthly. As is the heavenly, so also are those who are heavenly. Just as we have borne the image of the earthly, we will also bear the image of the heavenly. Do you not get this? Oh my gosh. This is so cool. Oh, this is so cool. Oh my gosh. Let's rewind the tape and walk through it. The first man is a living soul. He was made. Okay? Adam, but the last Adam is a life-giving spirit. He is the source of it. Hey, that's super cool. The nature of Adam was natural. Remember, he was made from the dirt, from the earth, from the ground, right? Not so with Christ. He's from above. Adam was given life. Christ has it. No one gave it to him. He has it. One of them is from earth, from the dirt. The other one is from heaven. Natural, spiritual. Paul's point here is since we wear the image of the first Adam, we will wear the image of the second one. We will be like him. Oh, man. I wish I could just take my head and give it to all of you. And we just have a big party, man. Do we not see the implications of this? If we thought like this all the time, how would this impact our decisions? How would this impact how we treat each other? How would this impact how we look at life and the things we do and the way we think if we saw ourselves as this? The fifth section, the resurrection logistics. Logistics, the way things go, the mechanics. This is where we get to verses 50 and following. One of the most fantastic passages. It was read this morning. He says, now I say this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Matter of fact, this, by the way, this isn't new news. Jesus talked about this to Nicodemus in John 3. I encourage you to go back and read that. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. Ain't that something? Not all of us are going to die. Some of us are going to see this happen. But rest assured, we're all going to be changed. In the moment, the logistics, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we, that is those who are alive, will be changed. For this perishable must put on the imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality. But when this perishable will have put on the imperishable, and this mortal will have put on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? Folks, we can't say this yet. because we're still dying. But when the resurrection and the catching up of the saints happens, I promise you, this will be our chorus. Amen. Probably when we're on the way up. Because remember, death is a foe. And when we become imperishable, death is destroyed for us. Notice this. This is so cool. The word imperishable is the same word that's used in chapter 15, verse 42, when he's talking about the perishable body raised imperishable, talking about the dead saints that are in the ground. They will be risen in power and glory. This deals with live saints. We will be made the same as them. The sting of death is sin in verse 56. And the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through Jesus Christ. The sting of death is sin. This is the reason why we die in the first place. That's the sting. That's where it comes from. This is the origin of death. It splits up families, splits up friendships, marriages. Leaves us lamenting, tearfully. It is because of the nature of sin that this happens. And the power of sin is the law. You know, the law informs us of the origin of this. It gives us knowledge of sin. That's Romans 2. This is the reason why we die. That doesn't mean the law is bad. It just informs us of the problem, of the issue. However, Paul doesn't stop there, does he? He says, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord. Victory over what? Keep that in mind, because we're going to get that. We're going to get there in a minute. Therefore, my beloved brethren, because of all of these, you know what the therefore is? All of the implications that are talked about beforehand. All of the stuff we went through. Therefore, because of all of this, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your toil is not in eke. That's the same word in verse 2. Your belief is not empty, and neither is your labor. He brings it back together. Didn't I say, if we focus on the resurrection, how would that impact the way we live and the way we think and how we see each other and our labors? Oh, I missed it. No, it's not eke. It's kenosis, empty. It doesn't matter. It's still the same. See, I told you I'd get ahead of myself. I should stop doing that, but that's okay. So remember that question we talked about? Remember, I haven't forgotten it. Maybe you have, but I haven't. Okay? Saved or delivered from what? What do you suppose, based upon the context that he's talking about? Oh. Yes. Thank you very much. Saved from death. Death. That's what we're saved from. Yes, we are saved from hell. We are saved from that. That is true. We are saved from condemnation. That is true. We are saved from eternal judgment. That is true. That is true. Can I say that again? That is true. But let's not forget this either. We are saved from death. Whether we pass physically or whether we remain until the appearing of the Lord, we are delivered from that. Now let's get to the observations, because this is so cool. The conclusion of this text and all of the subsequent information surrounding this chapter accounts for the historical, physical resurrection of Christ. It's not just that we believe this exists by archaeology. It's our very lives depend on the fact that he resurrected. This is history. And if this is historical, guess what else is going to be historical too? Our resurrection. This conclusion accounts for the true and accurate testimony of the message of the apostles. We can trust the apostles because this is true. These things happened. And everything that they wrote, we can put our assurance in. The conclusion accounts for the necessity and installation of a messianic age. Folks, things will not be like this for long. I know that there's chaos in the world. I get it. It frustrates me to no end too. It's not going to be like this forever. I promise it's not. Not because of me, but because God promises that it's not going to be like this forever. One day it's going to be our turn to execute justice and righteousness. Not yet, but it will be. This conclusion accounts for the point of extreme suffering and affliction of the apostles. These apostles suffered. All of them died with the exception of Paul. With the exception of John. John was sent out to some island off the middle of nowhere, Patmos. But all of them lost their lives. By the way, this also accounts for our suffering too. And our pressures, and those afflictions that we have. This accounts for the quality of a body a believer will receive after one dies. This chapter accounts for one, how one will receive this new body. Again, once more, it's connected to reality. Folks, this new body will be as real as the sun coming up. It'll be as real as we see each other. It's as real as these chairs you're sitting in. Without the resurrection of Christ, reality would cease to exist. It's amazing. This chapter accounts for the victory, not just over sin, but the ultimate effect of sin, which is death. Death. And this conclusion accounts for the believer's life and significance of the believer's labor. Nothing that we do is wasted when we see it from this perspective. Nothing we do is wasted. Consequently, we can lose focus as well. And we ought not to do that. Okay, real quick. How about the implications? Of course, we don't live in Corinth. Okay, we weren't there, but we believe the same thing the Corinth believers do we not? So there's some things that apply to us, real fast. First, as believers, we need not fear death. We need not fear death. Let me say that again, for those in the back. We need not fear death. Which we are saved from death. As believers, we ought to be intentional. That ought to be our word. To live intentionally with our lives. about how we live and the decisions we make. And if we're not living intentionally, we ought to start doing that with our motivation of knowing that we will be resurrected as Christ was. The resurrection of Christ underscores the validity of God's word. Reality and history, all of it is connected. All of it. This is why we're here. At least we ought, this is why we ought to be here. And lastly, the resurrection underscores the grace of God. We don't deserve this, but God, due to his grace, gives it to us anyway. God is amazing. He is amazing. And I am so, I'm so thankful and grateful that those of you who are, who I get to labor with and talk to here at Open Door, that this will not be a goodbye, that we will always be together. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful promise. Let's go ahead and pray, and I will close us out here. Lord, there are so many things happening in the world, among which those is death. Lord, there are relatives that we miss, friends that we miss, people who we think about often and often shed tears over because we miss them and we want to be with them. But Lord, we know that those believers who have gone before us that we miss, we know that we will be with them again, and there will be such joy and celebration knowing that they will be resurrected with a new body and an imperishable life, indestructible. And that we get to be amongst our Savior, our Lord, who has made all of this possible because of his work and because of the fact that he has been resurrected. May we continue to focus on this, and may we all live intentionally, focused on that day when this becomes reality. For it's in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together and respond with one more hymn. Thank you so much, Luther. Of course, this hymn paraphrases Psalm 23. Let's rejoice with David that we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
My shepherd will supply my need. Jehovah is his name. In pastures fresh he makes me free, beside the living stream. He brings my Spirit back when I forsake his ways, and leads me for his mercy's sake in paths of truth and grace. When I walk through the shades of death, thy presence is my safe. One word of thy supporting breath drives all my fear away. Thy hand inside of all my faults doth still
Time we will be at home, but for now we live in the light and the truth of the resurrection this week as we go forth. Blessings. Thank you.
Jeff.